Hey folks, it's Ray at DCRainmaker.com here, and today I've got the KOM Cycling RPV2 rocker plates. It's a bit of like a double cheeseburger of rocker plates. It's got three patties down there, got a bunch of meat in the middle that makes it all work. It goes forward, it goes backwards, it goes side to side. It's a little bit different than a standard rocker plate, kind of more in line with the Saris MP1 rocker plate that came out about a year and a half ago. So if you're not familiar with the rocker plates, the 20-second story there is that basically you get movement. So you get side to side movement like this, but in the case of the RPV2, you also get forward and backward movement. So you can go ahead and sprint forward and it gets a little bit of acceleration feel to it as you go forward or backwards. But the thing is about rocker plates is that it's easy to demonstrate like the strong sprint and moving all over the place, but that's actually not the benefit. In fact, I find that that whole like sprint scenario on a rocker plate is the low point of the entire rocker plate experience. Instead, the high point is just boring riding because it feels better. It feels more natural. As you're riding along, you get a very slight little bit of movement the entire time, which relieves pressure on your butt because your butt is sitting on a saddle. And normally when you're outside, your bike's moving a little bit versus inside on a normal trainer, it's not moving at all. Now we'll get to all the ride feel stuff in just a second. Let's first quickly talk about some of the specs though. Number one, probably the most important thing, it's price. It's $799, which is pretty expensive in terms of indoor training accessories, but it's cheaper by $400 than the $1,199 Saris MP1. But don't count those like eggs quite yet because they are different. There's some fundamental differences to how they're designed that are actually kind of a sort of big deal, and you can decide whether or not it makes a difference to you. Okay, so now assuming you go ahead and buy one of these, what do you get? Well, you get a big ass box, and inside the big ass box, you get this rocker plate essentially fully assembled. Double cheeseburger is made. The only thing you have to do is stuff two balls inside this cheeseburger and pump those up. And you've got this nifty little instruction sheet right here that tries to explain to you how to do it. And I would say like, this is probably the weak point in this entire thing. And it sounds obvious looking at this, you're like, pump up the two balls, hope for the best. But there's no pressure gauge on the little pump they give you, which they do give you a pump, which is nice. So you're kind of doing this by feel, trying to figure it out. And so that's probably the one where I would say it could be improved. But once you get them pumped up, it's great. And what that allows you to do is to adjust the pressure of this. So if you pump up one side too much, then you're going to tilt like this all the time, or the opposite, but also can control the feel. So you can play around with the pressure in those two balls to go ahead and decide how much resistance you want on either side. Next, we need to get our trainer on board here. So in this case, I've got the kicker on there, but it works with virtually every trainer. You'll see all these different slots right there, and you've got these straps that go ahead and strap on it. You just simply strap it in there and you're good to go. Like it takes a couple seconds. With something like the Saris H1, 2, or 3, they are offset more to the left. So you have to play with that a little bit more than you would something like the kicker, which is a little bit more center balanced. You could put a Wahoo Kicker Climb on here. There's a picture of that right now. It's all right. I've done kicker climbs on these rocker plates in the past, and it's kind of like a sort of experience. Some people love it. Some people hate it. I'm kind of in the middle, like three bears, middle oatmeal sort of lane. Like it's a little bit weird to me because it's not quite designed for this. But people certainly do it and it works out more or less just fine. You can also barely fit like a kicker bike on this too and stuff like that. But I find that just gets things really high up, way higher than I would normally want from a trainer standpoint. So it's not really my cup of tea. But again, technically you can do it. The maximum load allowed on this is 425 pounds, which is way more than most people's bike plus themselves. And if you look at the smart bikes, they're all like in the 100-150 pound range. So you take that plus your weight. And most people are probably good in that case between their body weight and the smart bike weight, or their body weight, the trainer weight, and their bike. And then up front, you've got your front wheel gone ahead and connected up there with the strap as well. Pretty straightforward. I haven't had any problems with movement of my trainer on the platform. Everything's exactly where I want it. It's been stated this entire 2 months. It's happy. There's also this grippy surface right here and right here. In fact, I would say this is an area that does have an edge over the MP1, and that the MP1's grippy surface is really, really grippy, but too grippy, meaning it's miserable to clean. If you get like gels or something on that, you try to then take a cloth over that, the cloth just completely separates. It's like trying to use gel cloths on sandpaper. It's miserable. This is not as grippy, but it's functionally grippy enough, and you can still clean it relatively easily with any towel or rag without like shredding the towel apart and leaving all the threads there and cleaning it up, and you get it, right? Like this is good. I'm happy with this. Oh, hey, and a quick note, if you're finding this video interesting or useful, simply whack that like button at the bottom there. It really helps with this video and the channel quite a bit. I would say the only critique I have of the packaging is it probably needs a little bit more of it, which I rarely say, but you can see there's a little bit of rubbing marks on the edges of the plate on the bottom in particular. It's something that the company says they're looking into to try to fix for kind of like a future production wave. Now, if you already have one of their existing rocker plates, you can buy an upgrade kit that basically gets you that extra patty and bun that you put in the bottom that gets you the forward and back movement. That costs $450. And normally their base model is $450. So you are paying a slight premium if you were to buy those two pieces and stick them together. But if you can't make the budget work right now, that's always an option down the road. Or if you have one of their existing products already, then you can go and upgrade this way as well. So starting with those two balls to kind of understand how this all works. The first part is that this top plate, these top two plates here are what tilts side to side. So you see right here, as I go like this side to side, these bottom two plates are not moving side to side. The movement is only restricted to the top plate that goes up and down, and the bottom plate acts like a base. And that's in fact because their other unit that they sell, that's about half the price, basically just the top two layers without the bottom moving forward and back. So in this case, I can do this, as you're seeing it now on the bike moving side to side, and you get about 9 degrees, almost 10 degrees of tilt on that side to side. Now, officially the specs say 13 degrees of tilt, but I don't see how they're getting that. And I've measured this the same way I measured other rocker plates in the past. So I'm not quite sure on the 13 degree side of it, but I can squish it at 9 degrees. That's the most like movement I can get side to side. I've measured it at both the base as well as on the saddle, and it's pretty much the same. Now, you may be wondering, how stable is this? I'll show you. So in this case, you can see I'm standing on it on the very edge. So I've got it completely compressed on this side, no problems. If I go back to this side over here, I'll do the same. So I will stand on it, and you can see I'm now holding on the bike, and I'm getting a little bit of lift on that side over there. But like, I'd have to really pull on this to completely pull off the wall, which if you're getting this far and you're pulling yourself over, you probably got other issues. On the bike itself, of course, you're much higher up. You can see here, for example, where I've got it, I'm basically sitting on top of the bike, leaning all the way to the wall, and it's still not flipping over into the wall. Again, not saying you can't flip it, of course you can, but I'm just not gonna try to flip it. But like in my day-to-day riding, it's almost impossible to flip unless you doing something stupid. I don't know how else to explain it than that. In any case, the next piece is forward and back. And this is probably the most important piece, not just for this rocker plate, but understanding the difference between this rocker plate and the Saris MP1. So as you see here, when you go forward and back, what happens is that these top two plates move together all the time. And instead down below here, this acts as your base and you're rolling on these three sets of rails. There's one set of rails right here, one set right here, and then one set up in the front there. And they're completely flat rails. And then what happens is there are two springs. They go from essentially right about here, right below your bottom bracket, over to essentially there, onto those rails. And that provides resistance. So as I pull it back like this, this spring expands, and then boom, it contracts and it pulls you back forward again. And it's a strong enough spring that's gonna be able to pull your entire body weight on these rails with the ball bearings inside of there. Now, as you may have heard, like, listen to it carefully, and I may have to add the audio back in later on, the springs aren't silent. So listen to this. You can hear the twang. You hear the both the bottom portion, which is like the ball bearings on the rails itself, as well as the twang. Now, it's less twang and less loudness than your drivetrain, at least my drivetrain anyways, but it's not as silent as the MP1. The other thing is that it's hard stops effectively, because unlike the MP1, which has a curved bracket there, or curved mount, this doesn't. They're completely flat rails. So with the MP1, you're using your body weight to overcome that curvature, just like you would like cresting a hill. But here, it's flat. So if I go like this, boom, you can hear it click, right? It's hard. Now, you get that same hard sensation on the MP1 as well, but it's much more difficult to get to that point. Versus here, your travel is effectively shorter, and it's a much harder, like, abrasive boom when you hit it. But you're only going to hit it when you sprint, and you're not necessarily going to hit every single time. Over time, your body will effectively adjust to riding this to know, like, not to overshoot that forward momentum, if that makes sense. Anyways, it's part of, like, cycling rocker plates in general that your body has to adjust. And that's because when you sprint on something like this, the rocker plate actually goes the opposite of what it does outside. And that's something that, you know, depending on which camp you're in rocker plates, camp one says that I should be able to ride outdoors just like indoors. And if I have to ride something different indoors, all bad. Camp two says, suck it up, buttercup, learn how to ride indoors. It's different than outdoors. I'm kind of in the middle. I generally sit in the lane of I'm not going to relearn how to ride my bike indoors just for the benefit of sprinting. That's something that if that happens naturally, fine, but I think it's kind of silly to tell people to do that. at the same time, I don't think the benefit of this sort of thing is for sprinting. The main benefit is simply just riding along. It's that slight movement side to side sensation that on a long ride feels a lot better. And in fact, that's one thing I like about the KOM Cycling platform is it does not talk about making it an outdoor ride feel experience. Just like Saris, neither company sits there and says they're trying to simulate the outdoors. They both recognize that outdoors are outdoors and indoors are indoors, just like I can't change the fact that at the end of the day, I'm staring at a wall with a screen on it. It's not outside. It's a different sort of thing, and that's okay. Okay, so there you go, a complete look at this. Overall, I'm pretty happy with it. Like, I like this. It's a good setup. It's $400 cheaper than the Saris MP1. A lot of you are probably asking, do I get the Saris MP1 or this? And I could do a lot with $400. Like, the Saris MP1 is great, but as I said, since day one they announced that, that's really pricey. $1,200 for indoor cycling accessory, that is as much as this kicker itself is to then put it on a piece of wood. But it's also really good. It's certainly, there's no doubt in my mind the MP1 is a better rocker plate than this. There's really no question there. It just feels better. Is it $400 better though? Not in my opinion, but for some people it may be, just not mine. Then the next question is, do you spend the extra $350 over the base $450 model that goes side to side for the front and back? That's a tough question. I think the front and back, even though it's got those kind of flawed endpoints, if you will, where it's a little bit harsher than I want it to be, it does add so much more because of that very subtle movement forward and back. To me, that's just that little bit right there is the main thing that makes this whole thing so much better than a typical side-to-side rocker plate. If you found this review interesting, useful, informative, something, I don't know, just simply whack that like button at the bottom there or hit subscribe for future sports technology goodness. With that, have a good one.